and some folk come to participate. Come on, help me in here. But I'm looking for some participators in the building, because if you came to church to participate, I came to church to participate. Neither one of us have any time to look at each other, because we're too busy looking at him. Look at your neighbor and say, I came to participate. Look at the neighbor behind you and say, quit looking at me. Watch this. Teach more. Watch this. I'm you. Believe it or not, I'm almost out of here. Charlie, put the cab on standby. Watch this. Jesus went to a party. His ministry is fresh, and he's invited to a party. Where wine is. Huh? You ready for it? Spirits are at the party. He shows up with his disciples. Are you in here? And something happens at this party. Now, by way of historicity, can I help you just for a moment? This is a problem, because Galilee was separated and divided into two parts.
All right.
Now, these two parts paint a very vivid picture, if you will, of what Dawson likes to call the haves and the have-nots. There was one part that was located down by the Sea of Galilee that was perhaps the not-so-well-to-do section. They were said to be the poor and to have very little means. They were the ones who perhaps had to scrape the bottom of the barrel to get by. Anybody ever been there?
Yeah.
And the idea of ever getting ahead was slim to none. And next you have, that was the area of Canaan, which was the well-to-do area of Galilee. In other words, it was the Taj Mahal. Are you in here? The upper class, you know, the higher echelon. Come on, talk about, huh? The folks who lived in the glass houses. The River Oaks folk. Come on, talk about, huh? They could get whatever they wanted, whenever they needed. Come on, y'all. They didn't have to ask nobody for nothing, because everything that they needed, everything they could ever ask for, they already had it. So they didn't, come on, help me, huh? They didn't need to ask for assistance from anybody. They had the food, the car, the house. Come on, y'all. And the clothes, huh? They had the shoes, the turkey, the ham. Come on, y'all. They had everything that they needed to get by. And so people who lived here, they could do as they well pleased. They could go as they pleased, huh? And they could do whatever they wanted to do, because they had the resources to do it. And so Cana is the place that ran out of wine. Now, you have everything you need, but you run out of wine. You have the resources. Come on, help me in here. You have the house, the clothes, the family, the fame, the fortune. Yet you run out of wine. Now, opposite side of Canaan would suggest that they would not have enough wine. But Canaan should never run out of anything. So it's strange that a place like Canaan could run out of wine after all they got it going on. Come on, help me in here. They don't need to ask anybody for nothing. They can do anything without hesitation or reservation. They don't owe an explanation to anybody. They can go in as they please, come out as they please. They can, their children can go to the best schools. They can live in the best neighborhood. on the groom's shoulders.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so to run out of wine, the guests would be embarrassed. Huh? Everybody would be embarrassed. The bride and the groom would be embarrassed. And the groom could possibly face legal ramifications. In other words, his in-laws could sue him because he ran out of wine. Lord have mercy. Huh? You see, it's enough that we run out. But you gonna sue me because I ran. So I'm already faced with a problem. Huh? Now watch this. We're on the pinnacle of the mountain. Everything is good. We're at a party. We're at a wedding. The groom's happy. The bride is happy. Everybody else is happy. But we run out of wine. Come on, help me in here. So this is troublesome, brothers and sisters. If you understand, this is troublesome. This is a troublesome situation. Because our biblical understanding of wine is that it is indicative of joy.
Yeah.
Are you in here?
Yeah.
When you have the spirit,
yeah.
It brings about a level of joy.
Uh-huh.
Are you in here? Now Flip Wilson would tell you, no joy juice allowed. But in this text, it's allowed.
Yeah.
Come on, help me in here, huh? Everybody in this wedding, every attender of the wedding is able to partake of this joy juice. Are you in here? We're going somewhere. The rabbi said that without wine, there is no joy. So to run out of wine would be almost equivalent of admitting that neither the guest nor the bride nor the groom were happy.
All
right. Everything is going good. Folk come from far and wide, near and far, to come to this wedding. Jesus is there. Disciples are there.
Yeah.
Mary, the mother of Jesus, is there.
Yeah.
And Mary gets wind that the wine wheel is depleted.
Yeah.
Teach, boy, I'm almost out of here, so I'm closing up my book.
All right.
Huh?
Yeah.
We ain't got no more wine. The joy juice has lost all of its juice. Somebody needs to do something. Are you in here? And so, brothers and sisters, somebody said no more. You ain't gonna call it, but you know what it is. Pastor Terry Anderson said this morning, he said, now understand, I think I need to tell you here parenthetically that we're not supposed to drink. We're not supposed to get drunk. He said, I'm going to be frank with you. Y'all heard him this morning, didn't you? He said, to be frank with you, you know, I'm standing up here, but I got some Moscato. There you go. Come on, talk back to me if you can, huh? Huh? Whether it's peach or green apple, sometimes you need just a little bit. You don't want as much to get out of character. You're not trying to trip on nobody. You're not trying to get upset, huh? But just a little shot and let me go to sleep some. Yeah, calms my nerves. Keeps me rooted. Because of the trials of life. Talk back to me if you can. And so Jesus responds to his mother as she comes to him and says, listen, we ran out of wine. Jesus responds with that great Greek word gun, G-U-N, Greek word for woman. It's a term of respect, but not of warmth. Jesus responds, if you will, with a gentle rebuke.
Yeah.
Well, I'm almost out of here. I'm making good time. And so, Jesus understands the problem. But he's trying to get over to his mother.
Uh-huh.
There is a problem.
Uh-huh.
But this ain't my time to handle a problem.
Yeah.
Are you in here?
Yeah.
You see. I came to fulfill my father's will. Now I hear what you're talking about, but I got something else going. Come on, help me. I got something else. It's hard, it's bad grammar, but it's good understanding. I got something else going. Here it is. Anytime God has commissioned you to do something, you ought to turn a deaf ear to anybody that's trying to get you to do something else. Because you have to fulfill the will of your father. But Jesus, say, okay, you know, my mama say what I gotta say to you. So between mother saying to son, God stepped in and touched him.
Yeah, all right.
You see, he didn't spend a long time dialoguing with mother. He just said what he was gonna say, but he was still gonna do whatever he was gonna do. Come on, y'all. You know how it is with some of us. You know, I can hear you and I can tune you out at the same time. In other words, I hear what you're talking about, but I'm gonna still do what I'm gonna do. Do you have anybody like that in your family? Do you have anybody? Come on, huh? Have you ever pulled up to the family reunion and you rang? So come on, y'all, huh? You heard them say rain potato salad, but you bought rice because you was just gonna do what you was gonna do. And then just like that in church, can you please pray on the, I'm not gonna pray on the program, but I'll give the Easter speech. Come on, y'all. Somebody here can testify that it's our natural proclivity to do what we want to do. Natural. And it's okay.
Yeah.
God will put you in a position where you can't do what you want to do. Because it's not about you. It's about him. You allow Satan to steal your joy, steal your peace. Shame on you. Because it's not about you. It's about him. Woo. So now, I'm almost out of here. Amen. I'm on the wedding party has a public problem.
Alright.
It's a public problem.
Mm-hmm.
It's not private. So they have a public problem that can only be handled by a higher power. Rewind, play. Boy, that was a good one. You know what? I shouted about 3 weeks ago when I looked at the text. So I'm looking for somebody to say, wow. They have a public problem that can only be handled by a higher power. There are some things in your life that only God can fix. Come on, y'all. There's some trouble that you have that hangs on the horizon of your life. You don't know about it. You ain't seen it yet. But you trust God that God is going to handle it before it handles you. And there are some ways, y'all, that God is still trying to handle in you that you don't even know. Come on, help me in here. Is there anybody in the building who can testify? You have problems. I have problems. All God's children have problems. But God handles my problems and lets me know at the end of the day, you can be victorious because I've already taken care of you. So Jesus said, okay, mama, I hear you. Now watch this. How do you know Jesus is the problem solver?
Mm-hmm.
That takes me back to chapter 1.
Yes, sir.
He's already been what? Baptized.
Yeah.
Come on, y'all. Huh?